Hello, everyone. My name is Jennifer Lansford. I'm the director of the Center for Child and Family Policy here at Duke. And I am thrilled to have you here today and welcome you all both in person and on Zoom. The Center for Child and Family Policy has been very fortunate to manage the North Carolina Education Research Data Center since its inception in 2001. And the NCERDC has provided data for over 500 projects, including faculty research projects and doctoral dissertations, among other things. So thank you very much for attending today's workshop. It's co-sponsored by the Duke University Population Research Institute, also known as DUPREE. So I'd like to introduce Marcos Rengel, co-director of the science core at DUPREE, who will say a few words about its relationship with the North Carolina Education Research Data Center.
All right. Good morning, everyone. Thanks, Jen. It's great to be here. So this is indeed an event that is co-sponsored with DUPREE. Now you know the nicknames already. So this is, in fact, the first of two presentations that DUPREE co-sponsors with this group. And the idea here is to invest on the use of rich administrative data to conduct science-oriented population studies. DUPREE, let me say a few words so you understand why DUPREE is in this room at the end of the day. DUPREE is funded by NIH and is one of the first in the nation to advance the use of administrative data for population studies as a complement to rich survey data that has been the tradition in the field, right? So we understand that there's advantages of pursuing this new route. And I think we're glad to be one of the first in the nation to do so. As I mentioned, this is part of a broader strategy for DUPREE to invest in studies focused on local and regional populations. So Durham and North Carolina are the first steps in that direction. We have supported scientific advances on the use of electronic medical records, for example, within the Duke campus. And a lot of combinations of those data with other contextual information, including other administrative records, okay? And all this with serious focus on replicability and the care for confidentiality of this information, as we all should be aware of. The same efforts that we had in the past now apply to education records. We need to think about those in the same way. And the idea here is that we can bring the expertise developed by many DUPREE scientists that have developed work both on the medical side and on the education side, and the connection of the education records with vital registration, criminal justice, civil courts, environmental, housing, and military records. So all this are just a few of the projects that have been developed by scientists here that are affiliated with DUPREE. I will emphasize that our final objective is indeed to share with the scientific community the knowledge for the use of the data that can be instrumental for longitudinal analysis focused on important phases of the life cycle, in particular childhood. In doing so, we plan on advancing population studies more generally. So once again, welcome to this. I hope you enjoyed the presentation. That's very rich information that you're gonna get today. Thank you so much.
Thanks, Marcos. I'd also like to welcome attendees who've joined us over Zoom representing universities across the country, including in Pennsylvania, Georgia, Tennessee, Michigan, Wisconsin, and a shout out especially to those in California and Texas who got up especially early to join us today. I'd also like to take a moment to announce that Dr. Nicole Lawrence has been hired as the interim research director of the North Carolina Education Research Data Center starting July 1st. And in this role, Nicole will be leading several new research initiatives with the data center, while Kara Bonneau, whom you'll hear from very soon, will continue in her role with the operational aspects of the data center and is directing that aspect of it. So Nicole, I invite you to say a few words.
Thank you, Jen. I appreciate it. I'm really happy to be here and very excited about my new role as research director and the opportunity to serve in that role. I've utilized the data center myself for a number of research and evaluation projects. So I'm well aware and familiar with the treasure trove of information that is available through this work at the center. I also think that it seems some of the research questions that can be answered now seem even more imperative, given that the K-12 system is struggling and continues to in the aftermath of the pandemic. So excited about the prospects there. And I'm looking forward to working with Jen and with others to sort of build upon the work that Kara, who's going to be talking soon, but also Clara Mushkin sort of started. So excited about growing the center in new and exciting ways. So with that, I'll introduce Kara Bonneau. Kara joined the center in 2004 after completing her master's in sociology right here at Duke. She managed the creation of the longitudinal database using data provided from the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction, and she currently manages this very large data warehouse. So thank you, and Kara, invite you out.
Thanks, Nicole, for that, and thank you all for coming, both here and on Zoom today. All right. Okay, so the North Carolina Education Research Data Center was established in 2001 as a partnership between Duke and the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction with a research-centered mission to provide a user-friendly data portal for eligible researchers. The data center was established with the support of multiple grants from the Spencer Foundation and now operates as a self-funded service center at Duke University. So I thought I would start with a kind of an overview of the data that we have at the data center. Most of the data files go back to, we have some going back to the late 90s, but I'd say early 2000s is kind of the most consistent data that we have. The student level data are probably the most often requested. They're individual level de-identified data files. These include a number of things ranging from end of grade and end of course scores, standardized tests, such as advanced placement, ACT, SAT, course enrollments, which are at the course level. So an individual student will have multiple records in, say, middle and high school as they're enrolled in multiple courses. Student demographic data, including sex, ethnicity, economic disadvantage, and limited English proficiency, number of days absent, disciplinary infractions and suspensions, and high school transcripts. These student data cover nearly 2 million children in about 2,600 public and charter schools since the late 90s. And students in these files can be tracked over time, and that's regardless if they move across schools or districts. The next main set of data that we have are teacher data files. These include not only teachers, but also other certified personnel, such as administrators. So you can find like data on principals and assistant principals in these files as well. These data include teacher education, licensure, salary, and other teacher credentials. One of the really the main work of the data center has been to take the identified administrative files that we get from DPI, which are not at all research ready, come in a number of formats and are not necessarily clean or easy to use, and link those records across files and over time. Kind of when we started, things like end of grade scores came as a flat text file, one per test per grade. So each elementary school would send us a file for third grade, fourth grade, fifth grade, sixth grade, if that's included, and then each of those, like, every test at every school would have its own separate, like, Word document. So those things have kind of transitioned over time. Obviously, that's not really very user-friendly if you want to do research on statewide end of grade scores. So to just format, standardize, clean, and document those data is kind of the biggest amount, part of the work that we do. We've also developed a number of strategies to track children over time. And all of the student files that you would request from the data center, with the exception of the youth risk behavior survey, include this variable called MAST ID. And that's what you would use to track kids across files, across schools, and over time. Similarly, the teach ID variable has been assigned to all the teacher data. This is not linked to anything, social security number or the staff ID that's used by the state. So now they're just randomly assigned ID number that can be used by the data center to track teachers. A lot of teachers are in multiple schools in the same year, move across schools, obviously, throughout their career. And this variable can be used to link those teacher records over time. Additionally, the course enrollment data, which are pretty good on a statewide basis starting in around 2008, include math ID and teach ID. So this allows you to link students to not only their teachers, but you can see which kids are in a classroom together. So you can also, like, as kids move through school, they'll have multiple teachers. Some of the early work that was done, if you looked at research done on the end of grade scores out of the data center, it used a proxy for, it's a the exam proctor in the end of grade files. So that teacher ID is linked to the teacher that was on the end of grade record, who may or may not be the kid's actual teacher of that grade. And then end of course is even a little more messy. So just one day they might do the math end of course, and so you might have an English teacher proctoring a math exam. So it's not really a valid link. The course membership data that came in, that really allows us to have a valid link between this student was in this teacher's classroom for this subject with these other kids. So it's a really good source of looking at peer effects and student-teacher relationships. Before actually I move on to this, there's two other sets of data that you can access through the data center, and those are district and school level files. Primarily these come from the school report cards and district report cards that are available through the North Carolina Department of Public Instruction and the Common Core of Data files that are available through NCES. Again, these files are in multiple formats. I think school report cards have been in Access databases, multiple Excel files, and then the NCES data are kind of statewide. They're not subset to North Carolina particularly. They have different LEA and school codes, so it's not as easy to integrate into the student and teacher level data as would be ideal for research. So when the data centers have some free time, we'll download those publicly available files and then translate them to SAS, standardize them, write up some documentation that matches the student and teacher level stuff, and make those available as well, so that people can use like contextual information for the student and teacher level research. These currently are only available through, I think, about 2017 through the data center, but researchers can download comparable files directly from the internet from DPI and NCEF. Ideally, we'll like update those at some point soon, but because they're available already, it's kind of a lower priority task for the data center. Okay. So through the assignment of Math ID and Teach ID, we have de-identified data files that we can then provide to link to other things. Like that's really a kind of a key way that we've set this up. So if people have external data sets that they would like to bring to the data center, we can link those and then just add that Math ID or Teach ID and de-identify the file and give it back with all of the content that was initially provided, along with an identifier that can be used to merge the provided data to any of the NCERDC files. So here's just a kind of a list of some of the projects, some of the external data sets that have been linked, which you will hear more details about from some of our speakers today. Some of these started with small data sets. Like people would go into a school and do an intervention in like one classroom and not another one. And they would give us a list of kids and say, you know, we want to compare these kids to other kids. Can you flag which ones were in our intervention? So it started from kind of small things like that to now people are bringing in statewide data from other agencies. Julie has purchased some National Student Clearinghouse data for her sample of students, which I think she'll talk about. So it's really like made it much easier to, made it possible actually to just track kids not only in school, but look at other outcomes. So the customized data request process is basically you need permission to link whatever files you're bringing. So just need, say you've got something from DHHS, we would need a letter from them saying you're allowed to do this. They would have to provide the identify data directly to us. These are some of the elements that we would ideally want. We would want to have LEA, school code, grade, student names, preferably in separate components, preferably with middle name, date of birth, the UID that's used by DPI now. And we will use those to match our data to other data. Of course, this is like an ideal scenario. A lot of times people will have maybe like, I wrote in my first name, which is not my actual like formal given name, and my birth date and the county that I live in, and this is all you have. We can work with this, obviously not ideal, but it's really possible to link a lot of things. Over time, we've developed some really, I think, creative strategies to link such not ideal data to the student records. Now that we've been doing this for nearly two decades, we've developed even like it's a long manually coded SAS format that says, if this first name, if like date of birth and last name match, and first name here is Margaret and first name here is Peggy, that's the same kid. Like, so, but this is, you know, 100 pages long at this point. So it's possible to do a lot with a little, I think, because we've been doing this for such a long time. So for researchers interested in applying for data, it's a pretty straightforward process, all of which is outlined on our website. The application forms required include a cover sheet and a disclosure and destruction agreement. Researchers have to have IRB approval at the expedited level. Exempt research or an exemption does not meet the NCERDC requirements, despite the fact that they are not identified. Our agreement with DPI is that we have to treat these as confidential data, even though nothing that we're giving out has names or birth dates. Researchers are also required to submit a data security plan. Currently, we require that everything is stored on a secure network server. So I know a lot of researchers or universities are moving towards cloud storage. Right now, DPI has not approved that transition, so we can't approve like use of AWS or like Box or anything like that. At this time, we're kind of working on that, but in the meantime, it has to be on a secure server, which is generally still available through universities. All investigators and staff have to sign an agreement, and then we need an abstract and project description. So it's all really pretty straightforward. And turnaround time on proposals is usually within 2 weeks. You'll have feedback on an application. If there are no problems and you're approved, the data will be released pretty much as soon as we receive payment. So it's not a long, it doesn't really follow a standard academic timeline. It's pretty fast. We like to be pretty efficient and get people going with their research as quickly as possible. So that is the overview, and I'm happy to answer any questions.
Charter schools as well.
Yes, charter schools are included. Charter schools are actually identified. They're their own local education agency. So but they are in the data.
Another question online is, what is the criteria for
practicing
data?
So pretty much all of the outline that I listed, you need IRB from whichever institution is going to house the data. So in the event that you had researchers from multiple universities, everyone would need to sign the agreement, be listed on the application. but the IRB and security plan would be only for the location at which the data will reside.
Another question online is, who is eligible to request data? Do nonprofits are nonprofits eligible?
Yes, nonprofits, government agencies, and academic institutions are eligible, all of which, however, have to be in the United States. So you have to be physically in the U.S. to request data. Researchers from abroad could partner with someone at a university here, but the data cannot even be accessed from abroad. Like, they would have to come here to work on the data, or they could collaborate on just the writing part or share results, but the data cannot be accessed outside of the U.S.
Another question is there any educator demographic data?
Yes. Race, ethnicity, in some cases, age can be determined. There's years of experience, the university at which they obtained a degree, and what that degree is. So a teacher might have multiple records there.
A few questions. Another one is, are code books available?
Yes. So the code books are available. They're pretty straightforward and standardized across data sets. So if you kind of get the feel of one, you can easily like figure out the others. They're kind of grouped together such that if a data set stays the same throughout, like over many years, it'll just be like all of, a multiple year code book. If you'll notice on some data sets, there's different code books for like each year. And that's when there's like a lot of changes or changes to a code, like exceptionality, for example, at one point had like 6 categories and then 8 and then 12. So like they'll have different code books, but they are data specific. There's also on our website a list of a summary list of data and variables, which shows kind of what is in each data set. And of course, each data set often changes over time. And there's a snapshot though, like you can see in 1 year, this is what was in the student EOG file. This is what was in the student suspension file. And it might not be exactly the same for the whole range of years that we have, but it'll give you a sense of what is in each one.
Another question, is the linkage with National Clearinghouse provided with a charge or free?
So that would be with a charge. We do not have National Student Clearinghouse data. So if a researcher had a sample of students for which they purchased the NSC data, they could have that sent to us, and then we would link that for a customization fee. The state recently purchased NSC data for the entire public school, all the students in public schools. So they have that now. We are working on trying to like hopefully reach a data sharing agreement that we could integrate that with the data center. But in the meantime, it's on a per project basis, and people would have to purchase the data and then also pay for the linking.
How complete are data are teachers like with educational background test scores prior experience?
Those data are pretty complete, and the linking is actually kind of more reliable on teachers over time and across schools, because one of the primary components from that is social security number. So while there is like there's a greater margin of error in student linking over time, but the teacher data are linked across files pretty consistently, and there's not a ton of missingness in those files.
Another question is, I have been granted access to the data, but my university info security office is struggling to figure out how to set up secure network data. Do you offer support? Can I send them your way?
This is not the first time I've gotten this question. We do not have, we can't really offer technical support on the data transfer. So we have the way that it's set up. To access data, you would be given a guest account for the Duke system. You would download and log into Duke VPN and then map that to your server. Then you just copy over, you'll be given access to all of the files that you need, and you just copy those over to your server from the NCERDC server. This is sometimes kind of complicated, especially if people are logging into their server already through a different VPN, but various IT departments have been able to figure out a workaround. We do have our IT department here will help if they can, but the thing is, it varies. Ours is always the same. Like, we know what we have, and we know how you can get it. What you have will depend on, will determine what kind of alterations you need to make to the process. We can like approve some like temporary, like a temporary virtual machine that you would move it to and then log into your VPN and then move it back some different things like that. I personally do not have the technical knowledge to give any assistance with this. So we typically refer people to their own OIT.
So should this person follow up with you or?
Yes, and if people can't get it, they should just send me a note.
Okay. Yeah. Another question. Are there private schools in the data?
There are no private schools in the data. In the list of previously made available public files, there are data available out on the internet, not necessarily through us, on just public or private school enrollment with demographics and counts. So at one point we had downloaded those and kind of standardized them, made codebooks and posted those for researchers to download as more of a comparison. We know what all of North Carolina looks like, and we know what the public school demographics look like. What does private school look like for comparison? But those haven't been updated in several years, and I'm not sure if they're still available, but definitely don't have anything at the student level.
Does NCERDC have NC students post-secondary?
We do not. There are kids who are in grade 13 in some of the early colleges, but we have nothing beyond that.
Is access fee per project or per person? If I have a grad student that wants to work on a sub question for already a project, do I have to pay twice or just once?
So two different questions. The first is the access fee is per project, not per researcher. Part of this is kind of shifted over time out of necessity because the data center is supporting itself with funding, and we have a lot of people coming back we've used the data and it's great, now we want to do another project. We're kind of doing all the work to update the data and add new data, and the same people are using it, so we're just giving the data away for free. So now it's per project. We are currently waiving fees for graduate students. If it was collaborative work with the graduate student with the aim of publication, they'd have to pay another access fee. If the graduate student wanted to look at a question related to what the advisor is currently doing, they would submit their own student application to use the data for their dissertation on that particular research question. And in that case, the fee would be waived. So it's really, with graduate student work, the fee waiver depends on the intent of use. So if it's a dissertation research, we can waive that.
Average processing time assuming that an IRB is approved and no customization.
If there's no customization and there's no issue with the application, data are the approval is usually will do the review within a week. The access fee, that's usually kind of the longest holdup, and our administrative staff here is excellent. They usually send out the invoice within a day or two of approval. So it's really just a turnaround on when people can get the access fee into us. And as soon as we receive it, we'll go ahead and release the data.
Do you have students in the
district? We do not.
Some health-related information like health?
No, we don't have any health-related data. And medical data can also, in terms of what we can link, there is North Carolina legislation that says education records cannot be linked to voting records or biometric data, which health-related stuff, some of the inquiries we've gotten, DBI is kind of broadly defined biometric to mean anything health-related. So the feasibility of that really varies specifically by project, just even in terms of health and education linkages.
Are any data sets available for free?
If you're only requesting the school and district level data, then yes. Otherwise, there is the access fee, which, as I said, we are currently waiving for graduate student dissertation work.
Graduate student waiver, is it only for Duke University graduate students or any graduate student? What if the student intends to publish their dissertation?
It's for any graduate student and any publications coming from the dissertation research, that's fine. As long as the primary intent of the request is for the dissertation. If it's, the dissertation's on topic A and you're requesting data for topic B for presentation and publication and adding to your CV, that would not require meet the waiver requirements. But if you publish later out of your dissertation, that's fine.
Can't hear me, so I'll come a little closer. Do you need the same IRB approval for school district level data?
No. If it's only a school and district level data request, you don't need the IRB or the data security plan, because those are publicly available data that you could like technically go in and download on your own.
All of the publication. What is the process when somebody has a publication coming out? I think there is some reporting back to you.
Yes, thank you for bringing that up. I completely forgot. So it's in one of the agreements, the disclosure agreement, researchers agree to send us and NCDPI a copy of the paper for approval prior to submission of the manuscript for publication. We're not reviewing for content, or like we don't like, and we have to send it to DPI for their approval also, but it's not like we don't like this research, makes us look bad, or we don't like this kind of study. It's really just for checking the researchers have complied with all of the requirements in the data use agreement. Like they've signed this thing that says, you know, we won't put any cells smaller than 10 at like in a chart, or we won't use the term free and reduced price lunch. We'll only use economic disadvantage. So there's a lot of things like that, like standards that we have in our agreement with DPI, and people have signed that they agree that it will follow this. So it's mostly checking for compliance with that. So people would just send it to me. If the data center approves it, we send it to DPI, and then we haven't had any like rejected. We've had some small changes that were required, mostly around those like little things like cell sizes or terminology that people have agreed not to use.
On the website, there's also a publication.
Yeah. So once published, we also ask for people to send in citations and final papers. And there is also on the website a long list of many of the papers that have come out of work with the data center data.
And we have one more question online. Two more now. Are application lottery records available for oversubscribed or selective schools? As an example, exam schools, charters, centralized combined.
No, we do not have application data. There have been a couple of projects where researchers have worked with a district to obtain various application data, like for Charlotte-Mecklenburg at one point. And so if people apply to charter schools or just specific projects within districts, people have gotten those data directly from the district, brought those to us, and we've linked those to the records following kind of our standard customization process.
All right, and the last one, is the data linkage fee waived for PhD students?
So data linkage is not permitted for PhD students because of the complexity and time involved in that. We will only customize data for faculty projects. If a graduate student were to obtain funding for a customized project, they would collaborate with a faculty member at their university. It would be a faculty PI, and they'd be listed as a co-investigator. And then it would kind of follow all of the faculty application process, including the customization request and the customization fee, and the graduate student would just be an investigator on that project.
Great. What data are contained within the LEP data and our home languages part of that? I wanted to know within the LEP data, limited English proficiency data, what exactly is there in our home languages recorded?
For the most part, we do not have home language information. The more recent files, in several years, it's just a yes or no, limited English proficiency. More recently, we have yes, no, exited within 1 year, exited with 2 years. So there's a little bit more detail, but we don't, for the most part, have a home language. I think that's included in it's either like the ACT or SAT file, but it's on just a subset of students. All right, actually the one other thing I did forget to mention in terms of applying for data is our request process is on a file basis, not a variable basis. So when you're filling out the application and you submit your data request, it's at the level of the data set. So you really need to give some thought to I need test scores, but you don't need to think do I need the LEP variable? Do I need specific variables within a data set? So it does allow for some changing and shifting and adaptation of your research agenda over time, because you can get the whole file instead of having to do a variable element specific requests that we would then pull and give you only like a handful of things. So, and similarly, you would get the statewide file. Even if you're only interested in Durham, you get the whole file, you could subset to Durham and do it that way. But then you also have options for comparison districts or whatever else the case may be. Anything else? Okay, thank you guys for the great questions.